Once again, good morning, everyone. If we have tech glitches or visual glitches today, excuse us. We're doing the best we can. Can the Zoom audience hear? Okay, good. The Zoom audience can hear, they say. So, good. So, thanks to Katie for playing so beautifully. Sierra has lit the candles. Jim Pendleton is going to read the scripture today. This is his first time as reader. We're very glad to have him with us. And so once again, welcome everyone on the 11th Sunday after Pentecost. And would you please join me in the call to worship? O God, who makes all things new, new stars, new dust, new life. Take our hearts, every hardened edge and measured beat, and create something new in us. We need your newness, God, the rough parts of us made smooth, the stagnant stirred, the stuck freed, the unkind forgiven. And then, by the power of your Spirit, we need to be turned toward love again. Amen. Our hymn of praise, which Jean Potts will lead, is I Would Be True.
I would be strong.
We do have a few announcements to share today. First of all, thanks to Cheryl Cameron for the beautiful sunflowers on the altar. And with regard to flowers, we have a sign-up sheet right by the pulpit for you who are in person. Next Sunday is covered, but after that it's open. So if you'd like to bring flowers just for any reason, please do. If you want to put in the bulletin that they are in honor or memory of someone, let me know by Wednesday, please. Also, thanks and kudos to Michelle McCabe and Associates for updating the Standish Congregational Church Members and Friends Directory. I will try to get hold of those at the end of the service and hand them out to you, but they're behind the back pew. They're printed on green paper, so that would be useful information for everyone. So a few people's emails have changed, and so on and so forth. Also, next Sunday, August 15th, I would like to bless backpacks of anyone who is going back to school. So if you are going back to school as a student, one student is with us somewhere today, but if you're going back to school as a student, a teacher, or a staff member, please bring something that represents back to school for you, and we will bless it during the message for all ages. And I want to announce that Michael Nielsen has completed the playground outside. That was his Eagle Scout project, and we will bless and dedicate the playground on Rally Day, September 12th. Another thing that not everyone may know is that the Standish Food Pantry, which is operated out of our fellowship hall throughout the pandemic, will be moving to its new location, the former Sebago Lake Congregational Church, on August 23rd. So the food pantry will not be with us here much longer, but we want to continue to support it. And I want to say how wonderful I think it is that our sister church from back in the day, when they needed to disband, they chose to sell their building for $1 to the Standish Food Pantry. That's a great testimony to their faith, and I think we should all be really thankful to them for that. Does anyone else have an announcement, either online or in person? Starting with online, if you do have one, please speak up. Hearing none, does anyone in person have an announcement? All right, then. We will return our hearts more intentionally to the worship of God as we say together the prayer of confession. This prayer is based on Psalm 51, which is attributed to David. And those of you who were here last Sunday know why David has reason to feel very guilty and be requesting God's forgiveness. So this psalm is and the prayer based on it are a classic way of asking God's forgiveness for personal sins. So please join me in prayer. O God, we come to you knowing that our lives have not been lived in the fullness of your hope for our world. Be merciful to us, O God, because of your steadfast love. We have not always been sincere and truthful in our dealings with others. Be merciful to us, O God, because of your steadfast love. Remove our sin and its residue of guilt. Wash us whiter than snow. Fill us again with the sounds of joy and gladness. Be merciful to us, O God, because of your steadfast love. Create a pure heart within us and empower us with a fresh spirit. Be merciful to us, O God, because of your steadfast love. Please join me in a moment of silent reflection. My friends in Christ, God is quicker to forgive than we are to ask. Be assured that we are a forgiven people and move forward filled with God's love. Thanks be to God. Our focal scripture reading today is part two of a story that we started last week. It's the story of King David's fall from grace, which occurred because he committed adultery with the wife of one of his soldiers. Probably what he really did was rape the wife of one of his soldiers. She got pregnant, and he had the soldier killed in battle so that he could bring the woman into his house, marry her, and there would be no disgrace for the child. So that's really cutting down to the chase. In today's scripture reading, God is displeased with King David, and he sends the prophet Nathan to try to straighten him out. So please listen as Mr. Pendleton reads the passage for us.
Mr. Pendleton now very, very quickly became just plain old Jim. The reading today is from 2 Samuel, chapter 11, verse 26, and all of chapter 12. When the wife of Uriah heard that her husband was dead, she made lamentation for him. When the mourning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord, and the Lord sent Nathan to David. He came to him and said to him, "There were two men in a certain city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had very many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing but one little ewe lamb which he had bought. He brought it up, it grew up with him and his children. It used to eat of his meager fare and drink from his cup and lie in his bosom. And it was like a daughter to him. Now there came a traveler to the rich man, and he was loath to take one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared that for the guest who had come to him. Then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. He said to Nathan, "As the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die. He shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity." Nathan said to David, "You are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I rescued you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your bosom, and gave you the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would have added as much more. Why have you despised the word of the Lord to do what is evil in his sight? You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword. You have taken his wife to be your wife and have killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now, therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house, for you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, I will raise up trouble against you from within your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this very son. You did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the son. David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. Nathan said to David, Now the Lord has put away your sin, you shall not die. Nevertheless, because by this deed you have utterly scorned the Lord, the child that is born to you shall die. Then Nathan went to his house. Thus endeth the reading of the scripture.
What's it to you? I've seen this room and I've walked this floor. I used to live alone before I knew you. I've seen your flag on the marble arch, and love is not a victory march. It's a cold and it's a broken.
Jean, God bless you. What a privilege to hear that. And not only was Jean's performance wonderful, now I don't know whether you heard, I hope you heard some of the words anyway, and probably I'll find a way of getting those out to you. The words are very meaningful. And one thing I really like in that piece is his acknowledgement that sometimes all we can offer is a broken hallelujah. And that is still acceptable to God. There is another scripture reading today, a very brief one that the sermon title comes from. This is from the New Testament letter to the Ephesians. And it basically follows on from last Sunday as well. This is Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. The book of Ephesians is attributed to St. Paul. It is said to have been written by Paul when he was in prison. It may have been written by someone else in his name, but however it was written, it is authoritative scripture. And in this very brief passage, Paul is calling for Christians to live a life worthy of our calling. And so please listen as I read. I, Paul, therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. May God bless these readings from Holy Scripture. And would you please join me in prayer? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. A life worthy of the calling. That line was written to Christians, and we have to remember that King David was not a Christian. With that said, he is the ancestor of Jesus Christ, and he is the ideal king of the Hebrew people. So he's very important in the pre-Christian Hebrew scriptures, Old Testament. So once again, I'm doing a little bit of reading backward from standards that are set for Christians and doing a little of imposing of them on poor King David. But with that said, King David was called. So we're looking at a life worthy of the calling. We're thinking about King David's life. We're thinking about that injunction. We're thinking about our own lives. So King David, the shepherd boy, was called to be king of Israel. And God richly blessed this young man. He faced many challenges. He rose to them very well. In the passage that Jim read to us, some of the things that God had done for David are recounted. He helped David win in battle. He helped David prevail over the previous crazy King Saul, whom, as I said last time, David used to calm down King Saul by playing music to him. So he was actually a very virtuous man, given that he was also a violent warrior, but this was a warrior culture and he was fighting for God. So he was a valiant warrior, a good man, but the scripture reading last Sunday and this Sunday shows his decline. And that can happen to anybody. And it did happen to David, as we heard last Sunday and this Sunday. So this Sunday's scripture, it begins with Bathsheba mourning the death of her husband, Uriah the Hittite. David plotted to have Uriah killed in battle. And then David calls for Bathsheba to come and live in his home and be one of his wives. This is back in the day, pre-Christian, Old Testament times. It was customary for important men to have many wives and concubines. So Bathsheba is being added to David's harem here. And while we would not approve of that, at least I don't, it was the custom back then. And what it did for Bathsheba was it did protect her so that her child could be born into safety and be taken care of. And so could she. So she became his wife. God sent Nathan the prophet to David. Now, you remember my telling you, I hope, that one of the main things prophets do is speak truth to power, which is always a dangerous thing to do. Now, in fairness to David, and remembering that in many ways he's a virtuous man, David actually takes this very well. He takes Nathan's visit, Nathan's very tough words to him, very well, in that he does listen. He does not punish Nathan for these words. Nathan goes safely on to his home after his message to David, and David listens to it. David listens, and he says, "I have sinned against the Lord." And indeed he has. Thinking back to last Sunday, David is at home in his palace, apparently idle at a time of year when kings go out to battle. David doesn't. He has enough time on his hands to be up on his rooftop, surveying the scene and seeing Bathsheba taking a bath. No etymological relationship, by the way. But Bathsheba is doing what good Jewish women did and purifying herself after her period. Now, this whole story of David and Bathsheba is considered one of the best told stories in the Bible from a literary perspective. And forgive me, but I am a trained literary person. I used to be an English professor, and I can't help looking at this from a literary point of view. So I'm going to step away from the theological perspective and look at it for a second from a literary point of view. It is great literature. Great literature is always open to multiple perspectives, multiple interpretations. So some of the questions that this passage raises for readers inevitably are, what really happened between David and Bathsheba? And we don't know the answer. Again, it's open to multiple interpretation. What the scripture says is that David saw her taking a bath, thought she was beautiful, said, "Who is she?" Learned that she was the wife of one of his soldiers, Uriah the Hittite, sent his men to her and brought her to his house and lay with her. Now, from a very strict perspective, that the way I would usually tend to look at things, this sounds like a rape. David saw this woman, he wanted to have sex with her. He had his men come and get her and bring her to him. The word rape comes from the Latin word raptus, and that means abduction. So on the surface, this looks like an abduction and rape. Some interpreters, however, as some people in courts do today, have maybe not exactly blamed the victim, but have wondered if Bathsheba played a role in what happened. So to give this a fair airing, I will say some interpreters think Bathsheba liked David too, and that she was lonely while her husband was away in battle, and that she purposely took a bath in a place where the king would be able to see her. So that is a possibility. Again, open to multiple interpretations. Nevertheless, what happened to her husband was incredibly unfair, and they committed adultery. The husband is away in battle. David has him brought to David's palace. David tries to get Uriah to go sleep with his wife, as you heard last Sunday. That's a taboo thing to do in this warrior culture. You do not sleep with your spouse while you're engaged in battle. You are trying to stay in shape, I guess, stay in the right mindset. So no matter what David tries to tempt Uriah with, he won't do this. He won't go and sleep with his wife. So David plots to have him killed. And a really awful, ironic twist is David puts a letter into Uriah's hand. The letter condemns Uriah, and Uriah is told to take that to General Joab. And it is General Joab that gives the order that causes Uriah to be killed. So completely unfair to Uriah. And if it is a rape, a horrible thing to do to Bathsheba, David does try to make it right again by marrying her. Now, back to, so I was mentioning the great literature perspective just to say multiple interpretations. And now I want to go back to Nathan the prophet, who comes and, as part of this great literary masterpiece, tells David a very powerful parable. A parable is a parallel story that Jesus used a lot. Remember, that was one of Jesus' teaching strategies designed to make people really think. So Nathan wants to make David think and wants David to really realize what he has done. So the story, as you heard Jim Pendleton read, is the story of a poor man who bought one ewe lamb, female lamb. In the story, it's his only animal, apparently, whereas neighboring farmers have flocks of sheep. This man just has one ewe lamb. Cost him a lot of money, relatively speaking. It becomes a household pet, and it's as dear to him as if it were a daughter. And a wealthier neighbor is about to have company and does not want to slaughter one of his own animals, so he steals his neighbor's one sheep and slaughters it for their dinner. And so he takes the one thing the poor man has away from him and kills it. So again, multiple interpretations. In David's parable, who is the lamb? Now obviously, one way of looking at it is the lamb is Bathsheba. They're both females, for one thing. They're both very dear to the men in the story. They are the one, Bathsheba is the one wife of Uriah, whereas David has many wives and concubines. Looking at it another way, Uriah is the lamb. Uriah is innocent in all this. He's treated very unfairly, and he is literally slaughtered to cover what David and Bathsheba have done. So a very powerful parable, a very powerful story. When David takes it all in, he doesn't realize that the parable is really about him. So he says, "This is terrible. This man who took the other man's one sheep should be executed. It's completely unjust." And Nathan says to him, "You are the man." And he goes on to remind David of all God had done for him, and to put it real straightforwardly what David has done. And then David says, "I have sinned against the Lord." Now David has already said to, Nathan has already said to David that he is going to be severely punished for this terrible deed that he's done. His family will be impacted, and he himself will be killed, lose his life as a punishment. But when David says, "I have sinned against the Lord," Nathan says, "God hears." I'm paraphrasing, obviously, but "God hears, God forgives. You yourself will not be killed. Nevertheless, because you've done this horrible thing, the child that Bathsheba is carrying will die." And then Nathan safely goes off to his own house, whereas some kings would have maybe even killed the prophet for standing up to him like that. So in the scripture passage after this, the child is born, the child gets sick, the child dies. David prays for the child as hard as he can. He fasts, he lies outside the child's chamber, prostrate, hoping God will not go through with this, but the child does die. And then David gets up and eats and is himself again, and his servants say, "Why are you now eating? You know, when now the child's dead, why aren't you mourning for the child?" And David says, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." Now, this part about the child dying as a result of David's sin, I think is something that none of us want to believe. In fact, I do not believe that God punishes people by punishing their children. And a prophet who comes along not too long after this, the prophet Jeremiah, also disagrees with this. He says, God punishes each person according to their sin. He does not punish their children for their sins. So again, open to multiple interpretations, but I interpret that as an old-time Hebrew way of looking at things, not the way we have to look at things. So, quite a powerful story, and Leonard Cohen quotes the story in the piece that Jean sang for us, Hallelujah. I have to say I disagree with some of Cohen's interpretation of the story, but again, it's open to multiple interpretation. He seems to think that Bathsheba did participate in this and seduce David. So I don't believe that, but Cohen is not the only one who has seen it that way. But he sees himself in this story of David. He sees that he too is broken. I think if we all look at ourselves closely, we'll see that we have broken places within us too. And so that takes me back to really loving and appreciating Cohen's idea that Sometimes what we offer to God in praise is a broken hallelujah. Cohen also says somewhere else that the crack is how the light gets in. The crack in people, the crack in your heart and soul, perhaps, can be the way that God's light gets in. So even though, forgive me for reiterating some of what I said last Sunday, even though we haven't committed adultery and murder, we have fallen short. We have not always lived lives worthy of God's calling to us, at least not 100% of the time. And so, following David's example, we would listen when we're confronted with our sin. We admit it. We confess it to God. God forgives us, and we move on. That, too, is part of living a life worthy of the calling. So, thank you for listening, and amen. And we now come to the time in our service where we share before God and one another our joys and our concerns. Who has something to share today? I'll start with the online congregation. Does anyone online have something you'd like to share? Okay, well, I'll share as a general thing that I know some of you have health concerns, either right now or have had or are going to have health concerns. And so, in general, we pray for anyone who has had surgery or is facing surgery that God may be with you in your surgery and in your recovery. Anyone in the congregation have a joy or a concern to share? Norma.
I think it was very nice to get the organ in the hospital. It's nice to have the organ back.
Are you offering that as a joy?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Will?
Yes, I'd like to ask prayers for the family of Frank Richardson. Frank and I have been friends since 1961, and I received word from his daughter late last night that Frank is not going home, which is, I've known for some time. I talk to him every 3 or 4 days, and he's been going downhill, and for her to say it out loud, I must be getting close. So let's keep Frank and his family in our prayers.
Thank you, Will. So please remember Frank Richardson and his family in your prayers.
And I also have joy.
Okay.
As you're aware, we were on vacation last week. I posted several beautiful photos. And just a reminder that God's creation is just awesome, especially from a golf course.
Yeah, you sent me a lovely picture from, what was it, the deck in Bethel?
Yeah. The deck. The deck out of that condo.
Yeah, thank you. Kim.
Prayers for my cousin who just started being in prison a long period of time, that he survives and gets through it.
I want to make sure I understood what you said. Your cousin is facing incarceration?
Yes.
Okay. So we want to pray for your cousin for strength to make it through. Anyone else? Well, I want to acknowledge with gratitude my wonderful sister-in-law, Ruth Ann Biggar Claypool, who died at the age of 95 back in December in a nursing home in Acton, Massachusetts, of COVID. But with that said, she had had dementia for a long time. She was a woman of great faith, and I know she was ready to go. So we had her deferred funeral and burial yesterday, And I want to offer as a joy that I had a great visit with my two stepsons, Rob and Jamie, and Rob's wife, Angela. So that was a real blessing in the midst of it all. Anything else? And a huge joy for Jean Solo. And I want to add to Norma's joy, this was actually, Katie's organ was actually our keyboard. I think this is the second time it's been played for a service. It was donated to the church on Pentecost Sunday. So it was really nice to hear it played. All right, we'll go into a time of silent prayer, and then I will wrap it up, and we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. Let's be in a spirit of prayer in silence. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for summertime in New England. Even though it's a bit on the sticky side today, we're still grateful for summer blessings, the beauties of nature, flowers blooming, the garden coming in, time with family and friends, ice cream at wonderful ice cream stands in the area. All the things that we enjoy at this time of year. We give you thanks for beloved family members and for opportunities to spend time with them. Even as we lift up people who are dear to us, who are experiencing health concerns or nearing the ends of their lives. And so today we pray especially for Frank Richardson and his family and friends. And we remember Norma's niece facing a difficult diagnosis for a brain tumor. We pray that the medical personnel may make the right decision and that the family will know also what decision to make. We continue to pray for John Johnston, who had knee surgery a few days ago. We pray for John's recovery. We pray for others who either have had surgery or are facing surgery, that your healing spirit and your comforting presence may be with them throughout the whole process. We pray for people such as Kevin Lawler, who is just coming out of incarceration, and for Kim's cousin who is facing incarceration. We pray for their transition. We pray for strength for Kim's cousin that he may make it through. And we pray for all of us when we fall short, when we don't live the life worthy of our calling, that we may listen to people who try to set us straight and who are right, that we listen to them and that we ask your forgiveness, dear God. And we give thanks for the promises in Scripture and in our own experience that we can and will be forgiven. The psalmist said, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation." So we pray that with the psalmist, dear God, at times that we have or will have fallen or will fall short, We know that you forgive us. We know we can be restored to this community of faith, and we give thanks for that. All these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now please join me in saying the prayer of our Savior. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We now come to our offertory time. As always, I want to thank everyone who has been so faithful about keeping up with your pledges and your donations, helping us to keep doing God's work in the world, and also supporting our church in many other very important ways. So as Katie plays the offertory, please reflect on how you will continue to dedicate yourselves to God's work. Thank you, Katie. Please join me in the prayer of dedication. Generous God, you forgive us when we go astray. You make clean and pure our repentant hearts. Accept these gifts that we offer from our hearts. May these offerings help to heal broken bodies and troubled spirits in this your world. Amen. Our hymn of dedication, once again sung by Jean Potts, is Just As I Am Without One Plea. Yeah. I'm going to stand here for the benediction to make sure everyone can hear. Let's all try to live lives worthy of our calling to be people of God. But when we fall short, remember we can ask God's forgiveness and be forgiven. God will create within us clean hearts and renew within us right spirits. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen. Our service is ended. Have a great week, everyone. Hope to see you next Sunday.